and that is, like you said, it's so wonderful to go and just see the changing of the seasons. And I told Gary the other day when I was driving into Rochester, I saw a guy's license plate, and it was a Minnesota plate, and it said, "I hate winter." And I thought, he's in the wrong state, he needs to move. Minnesota, that's like 6 months of our year. So he hates winter, he's really miserable. Most of the time, that's bad, because there's so much beauty around you from winter to spring to summer to fall. Maybe he had a one-track mind, that's what we're talking about this morning. In December of 2006, 18-year-old Katie Davis of Brentwood, Tennessee, traveled to Uganda for the first time. She had no idea the course her life would be changed after that trip. She went there and she got a razor-sharp focus on the small corner of the world. In 2007, just a year later, Katie returned to Uganda to teach kindergarten at an orphanage. She was surprised by the number of children sitting on the side of the road working in the fields. There's no government-run schools in Uganda. They're only private schools, so only the rich and the upper class can afford to go to school. So most of the children don't, especially those that are orphans. Katie decided to set up a sponsorship program to match orphan children to sponsors that would provide educational funding, school supplies, hot meals, spiritual discipline, and medical care. By January of 2008, Katie had brought 150 children into the program. To date, over 600 children are now in her care. She also started a program in Karamojong community that feeds more than 1,200 children. They also receive schooling, medical care, and Bible study and training. The nonprofit that Katie established was called Amazonas Ministries International. It was established to meet the physical, emotional, spiritual needs of orphan children in Uganda. January 2008, Katie Davis became the mother of three of these orphan children. Today, she is the mother of 13 adopted Ugandan orphan children. And when people call her brave or strong or any of those things that you hear when you do something amazing, she always tells them, "I'm not really that brave or that strong. I'm not doing anything spectacular. I am just doing what God called me to do as a follower of Him. Feed His sheep. Do unto the least of these His people." She is only doing what God has called her to do. I mean, she was just a young college student when she went to Uganda. And now she's a mother of 13 children. She has a one-track mind for God. She looked at Him, she heard His call, and she obeyed. Katie's life is a great example of what it means to be single-minded, of having a one-track mind. Her life has meaning and purpose. When our lives are solely focused on God, when we make Him our number one priority, we can have a life of purpose and meaning as well. Unfortunately, it's really easy to get sidetracked by worry, by busyness, by a lack of direction. So as we turn, we're going to look at Matthew 6 this morning, verses 25 to 34, where Jesus is talking to it's part of the Sermon on the Mount, talking to them about having a single mind, by keeping the focus on Him, how our life can be so much better, so much easier. It is on page 787 of your Pew Bible there. Begins with, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds in the air. They don't sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you by worrying can add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which are here today and tomorrow are thrown into the fire, will He not much more clothe you? Oh, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you as well. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will have enough worry about itself. Each day is enough trouble of its own. The first verse is very powerful and often very convicting for most of us. Don't worry. Don't worry. The Greek word for worry here is merianeo, to be anxious, to care for. I am anxious, distracted. It means being over anxious, just thinking about something constantly, letting it bother you, letting it be just in the back of your mind all the time. So Jesus is telling people, don't be anxious to the point of distraction. Don't worry yourself sick. We all know that worry isn't good for our health. We know that it causes a number of major health issues, along with being hard on our relationships as well. Jesus isn't saying not to be concerned about taking care of yourself or about your families. Now, he's not saying that, but he is saying don't be overly anxious about it. He commands us to take care of our families. He commands us to work. He commands us to do the right things and to take care of our bodies. But he doesn't want us to worry, to be over anxious. Our life is more than just food and clothes. While Jesus was in Samaria, and he had been speaking with a lady at the well, the disciples had been in town looking for food and stuff to, you know, they were going to take a break, get some food, and have lunch. And when they got back, they said, you know, Rabbi, it's time to eat. And they said, Rabbi, eat something. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you know nothing about. And his disciples said to each other, could someone have brought him food? And Jesus said, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Don't you have a saying, it's still 4 months until the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for the harvest. So Jesus wasn't worried about eating. He was worried about telling people about himself, to share with them the hope of salvation, the hope of what his Father wants to do in their lives. As we get our minds and lives in line with God, he can and will keep us on track. Jesus said, don't worry about what you will eat or drink, or about your body, or what you will wear. Because our Heavenly Father knows that we need all those things. He knows what we need. He sends us to works. He wants us to find a job. He wants us to pay our bills. He wants us to plant food. Because we're wired to do that. He wants us to care for ourselves and for others, those that we're responsible for. But after food, Jesus discusses our need of clothing and shelter too. God clothes the plants and the flowers in the field. And he takes care of all of that. Won't he make sure you have clothes too? I mean, if he cares enough to take care of the plants and birds and all the stuff around us, won't he take care of us? We want so many things that aren't necessary. Like the lilies in the field, they only worry about themselves. They don't worry about, you know, how they're going to get their leaves on. They don't worry about if they're going to have seed. They don't worry about any of those things. God wants us to be like that, too. We don't need to be over-anxious about the stuff we need or want. Those that don't have a relationship with Christ are consumed by accumulating the things of life. But a believer who's in a right relationship with Christ looks to him first, and he takes care of those other things. He helps us to see the things that we really need, what's really important. A believer in God remembers that this life is only temporary, and we need to be storing up treasure in heaven, which is eternal. So we can relax. We don't need to worry. Because as Jesus said in verse 32, our Heavenly Father knows that we need them, our food and our clothes, our daily needs. He is our Heavenly Father. And like a good father, he is prepared to provide and care for our needs. When we keep our eyes on him, when our mind stays on track with the relationship with God as our goal, God promises to take care of our needs, to give us the grace, the strength that we need for every situation. The summation of all this is in verse 33. It says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. All these things will be given to you. That's the heart of the man, the main line of the track. Seek first his kingdom, that heavenly kingdom, and his righteousness. We are to make a living for God to be our top priority. When we get on a train, it isn't allowed to switch off and go somewhere else. A number of you have been on the train from Winona to Chicago. Well, you can't get on in Winona and decide that partway through that you want to go to Rochester. That train track will not move. That train will only go from Winona to Chicago. Winona to Chicago. And but it'll stop along the way, but it won't go off track unless it's by an accident or by a, you know, something happens. But it has to be on the track. It has to go where the track takes it. It can't change its mind and say, one day I'm going to go a different direction. When we have a one-track mind centered on a final destination, we know where we're going. When God's our final destination, we know where we're going. We are to seek God's righteousness, living a life that keeps God our focus, the main line, the main track. Someone has a one-track mind, they seem to talk and think about one particular subject all the time. If something or someone is a priority in their life, that means that that's the first thing they think about every day. That's the first thing they consider. How are they going to please them? How are they going to do something for them? It's just part of how we're wired. We put that one person or that one thing first. Jesus said our priority is to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then we don't need to worry about anything else. Because all the things, food, clothes, and shelter, will be given to us. God will take care of us if we place him in the first place position. We often speak about priorities. And a lot of us will say faith, family, friends, something like that. We'll put people all up there. So how do we put God first in our lives? I mean, it sounds easy. It sounds, you know, it sounds very spiritual, it sounds very religious. We put God first in everything we do. What does that look like? The fruit of whether God is first in our life revolves around these following questions. Is God first in your relationships? John wrote, "We know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. Anyone who does not love remains in death." Does our love for God sustain a difficult marriage or a wayward child? Can we extend unconditional love to the most ungrateful person in our job or in our neighborhood? Our love for God enables us to love them spiritually more than a natural love, which a natural love is one that we expect something back. We love because they're going to love us back. We don't love because we just do it. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we are able to live a one-track mind for God, and we can extend agape love, unconditional love to others in spite of their acceptance or rejection of us, of our love for them. It can't be God first and then we go on with the rest of our lives. We can't compartmentalize God. He is either God of all or he isn't God at all. Do we give God first place in our work or at school? Colossians 3:23 says, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters." Whether we're working at home or at the office, the factory, or at school, the Lord still expects us to be diligent for him, to serve him, to be honest, to give it our all, to serve without expecting anything extra in the paycheck. We may not get the extra bonuses. We might not even get the pat on the back that we deserve. Nobody may even notice that we're doing our very best. But God does. And that counts. If we're doing it for him, it won't matter if anybody else notices. A common channel that God is first in our life when our work reveals our true diligence for him. That we're doing our very best all the time for him. Is God first in our church involvement? Now you are the body of Christ and each of you is a part of it. We see it in 1 Corinthians 12:27. It must really hurt our Savior when he comes to church with us on Sunday morning sometimes. There are a large number of Christians that give so little of their energy to building the kingdom of God. A common challenge of every church and nonprofit is a lack of volunteers. Ideas may be given freely and often they're great ideas. But that might be as far as it goes. Someone else has to do it. And it's a great reminder that we need to make God's kingdom a priority. There's a song called "Do Something" by Matthew West. And I heard it on the radio a number of times and it caught me as I was preparing the message, and it says, I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble. Now, thought, how did we ever get so far down? How's it ever going to turn around? So I turned my eyes toward heaven, and I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. That thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven, and I said, God, why don't you do something? And he said, I did. I created you. I'm so tired of talking about how you're God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be like, live like angels or apathy, to tell ourselves, it's all right, somebody else will do something. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of life with no desire. I want a flame, I want a fire. I want to be the one that stands up and says, I'm going to do something. Right now, it's time for us to do something. If not now, then when? Will we see an end to it, to all this pain? It's not enough to do nothing. It's time that we do something. It's time for many of us to wake up out of our slumber and get busy in the church, whether it's teaching or preaching or serving or speaking. There's much need in the body of Christ, and each believer is equipped with unique spiritual gifts to contribute. When we put God first in our life, we will humbly serve in our local church and build up the body of Christ. Along that same track is the mission of our church. As a church, we need to have our mission in line with God. We need to be a one-track-minded church as well. We need to always be putting God first and his mission for us. Sometimes churches lose the vision. They're so busy doing programs or doing things that they forget what the main thing is. And the main thing, according to Jesus, was go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, even to the very end of the age. We are to go into our communities and our world, make disciples and baptize them. As part of the church, it's our responsibility to keep on track. For us to reach our destination, we need to be continually going out and reaching out to people. We need to continually be growing and serving and ministering. We can't just be happy with our own body of believers. We need to continually reach out and to minister to others. We need to be willing to change and to grow and to take risks and to commit as a body of believers. When we know, grow, and show, and go with Jesus' love, we are his hands and his feet to the community and those that we can influence every day. South Troy must continue to move outwards to share the great message of Christ's saving grace and the love for lost men. One great way to become more committed in the ministry of South Troy is to become a partner of the work going on here. We believe the term partner better communicates our position than those that have the highest commitment to the church. And it should be seen as a servant role, partnering with the overall ministry of our mission of our ministry. A partner is a friend of the ministry. A partner is someone who resonates with the vision of the church and wants to jump in with both feet and serve. A partner in ministry is someone that you turn to when the going gets rough and you need a hand. It's the person that rolls up their sleeves with you to serve together. Partners park in the back because they know that our guests park in the front. Partners save the best seats for others, and partners understand that it's a shared mission we find ourselves on. There are four core commitments and two other commitments that I would encourage each of you to consider to becoming a partner at South Troy. Well, a commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ is first and foremost. A commitment to the mission, values, and beliefs of the church. A commitment to the practices. A commitment to the leadership. And the last two are a commitment to the movement and a commitment to the lifestyle commitments. Those are the commitments that we have for a partnership with South Troy. Many of you already are doing them, but you haven't made a formal confession of faith. Many, and we have a number that have made that decision. But becoming a partner just gives you a little bit more responsibility, really. It's not really even that great of a deal sometimes, but it helps you to truly be a part of all that's going on. We also stay on track as we worship on Sunday mornings, Wednesday night children's ministries, Thursday night life group. We feed people through the food shelf, the backpack program, food showers, supporting our local communities as much as we can. Maybe in the future we can offer a daycare or school stop for kids. God has a plan for this church. And as we put Him first, as our first priority, we will make decisions that will impact our own lives and our community. When we have a one-track mind on God and His destination, we need to make God first in our giving of our time, our talents, and our money. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Do our budgets and our schedules reflect a generous spirit? Sometimes we allow the busyness of life to grasp our hearts subtly so that we're not even aware of it. We just kind of find ourselves always busy. Or we kind of find ourselves spending our time on things that really aren't all that important. However, if we seek the Lord first in our finances and our schedule, we find that our lives are much fuller, more contented, and then we don't have to keep up with everybody around us. God is first in our life when we choose His purposes and plans over our desired comfort level. When we give the first 10% to God in our finances, the next 10% of God to our savings to take care of ourselves and our family, and we live on those next 80%, life is a lot simpler. You already have it all taken care of. You put first things first. God has richly given us all things, yet He seeks the number one spot, even in our checkbook. Now, one-track mind life for God means we also put Him first in our recreation and our entertainment pursuits. Ephesians 5, 15 and 16 says, "Be very careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil." Many believers seek out distractions from the daily grind of life. We all need that. We all need to have, we all need to have time away. We need relaxation and entertainment. But sometimes, sometimes we enjoy it. Sometimes the only reason we work 5 days a week is for the weekend. We've lost our focus. We need to remember that God is still first, and He wants to be first in our recreation time as well. We need to resist the urge of living for the next happy moment. God needs to be first in our enjoyment and our recreation. He desires that we take care of our bodies. He wants us to get the rest and relaxation, but not so that we're only living for the weekend and not living to the full every day. Every good and perfect gift is from God, given to us for our enjoyment. As you enjoy God's provisions, be thankful. And your track is going towards His kingdom. Keep your priorities in order, even on vacation. God must be everything and in every part of our daily living. We live every day with an awareness of His presence and the power of God. For in Him we live and move and have our being. Our Lord is worthy of our attention in everything we do, in everything we say, and in everything we think. As believers, we have the Holy Spirit inside of us, prompting us toward righteousness in our attitudes and in our behavior. As we move in the Spirit, we can't help but put God first in everything. Because He's just the first thing we think of as we get up in the morning. As we come in each day to Him, our life becomes free and abundant and filled with purpose and meaning. Like that gal that went Katie that went to Uganda. You know that every morning she knows exactly what's going on. She knows what she's going to do with the rest of her life. And she's content and she's happy and she's following God's plan for her. That's what God wants for us. That's what Jesus said. He says, "I came to give you life and give it to you to the full." Life is easier, less complicated when our track is pointed toward God. We don't have to worry. At the end of Matthew 6, it reads, "Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." We don't need to get anxious or panicked or overwrought about tomorrow. Keep God first, and He will take care of the rest. So how do we keep our focus on Jesus amidst the distractions in our lives? We need to remember God is God, and you're not, and I'm not. God is God. The focus of my life is on Him. We need to remember that the authority of our lives is a Bible, and that has our attention, and it outlines our priorities. And our priorities come from the owner of life. They come from God, direct from Him to us. Put God first by simply loving Him and seeking to bring Him honor in all that we do. For a relationship to truly be a priority, we value 3 things. Honesty, communication, and commitment. If you think of your human relationships, I think you'd agree that those 3 things make a good relationship. Without them, a relationship's going to be a problem. There's going to be something wrong. Our relationship with God needs those 3 things as well, when we think about it. he wants us to be honest with him. And it's kind of silly not to, because he already knows everything anyway, so lying to God is probably one of the stupidest things we could ever do. But he wants us to be honest with him. He wants us to be honest with our feelings, with our doubts, with our struggles, with our joys, with our plans. He wants us to be talking to him and know him. Yet our honesty shows our trust and faith in our Heavenly Father. Having good communication is a good human, it's something that's very much needed in any relationship, and even in a marriage relationship. Even the state of Minnesota thinks communication is very, very important in a marriage. Because when you do the, when a counselor is helping premarital counseling, for them to get their certificate that says they completed 12 hours of premarital counseling, 6 of those hours have to be talking about communication. So obviously, even the state of Minnesota realizes marriages don't hold together unless you know how to communicate. Well, with God, he wants us to communicate with him as well. Not just Sunday morning, not just in a panic prayer, but all the time. Paul said, pray without ceasing. God wants us to be talking to him. He wants to talk to us. He's given us his word. He wants us to read it and put it into practice. To put God first, we have to communicate with him. We need to make reading his word a priority. We need to not just say our time with him is lukewarm, but to say it's hot, that we're part of what he's doing. We need to take time with God every day and show that he is important to us. And another important component is commitment, especially in a marriage relationship. Each person needs to be committed to choose to love each other, committed to stay together. Some of you can probably say this, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, until what? Death do us part. When we say those vows, we're committing ourselves to that other person until death. That's commitment. When we put God first in his kingdom, we are committing our lives to him until death. We're making him our priority, first, last, and forever. So what difference does it make in the way we live? Well, it makes all the difference, really. We will set goals informed by God's agenda, if you will. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Secondly, we don't ask God to bless our plan and then ask him to align his plan to it. Doesn't work that way. Psalm 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. When we put God first, our desires become God's desires. We're not fighting him anymore. When we love him and put him first, we're going to automatically want what he wants for us. We're aligned with him. We trust God to meet our needs and our desires. God loves us. He doesn't want us to say, well, you can't have too much fun, so you just have to follow my laws and you're just going to have to be miserable all your life here on earth. No, he wants to give us all these good things. He loves us. Good father. Most of us love to say yes to our kids or yes to our people that we care about. And that's what God does too. When we're following him and we're loving him, he wants to say yes to all those things that we want as well as those things that we need. When we take care of his kingdom, he'll take care of ours. The decision to follow God is difficult. Often God's plans are going to conflict with our plans when we first make that step. We will want God to bless our direction instead of us following his. But when we first focus on God, he promises to give us the desires of our heart. He works in us and changes us so that over time, his desires become our desires. And we will want what he wants and seldom struggle with staying on track with him. Once we put this principle into practice, our lives go from chaotic to simple and uncluttered because we have a one-track mind on God's purposes for us. There will be bumps and there will be bad weather, but God will still be in control, keeping us together. So just keep a one-track mind. Let's pray. Dear Lord, sometimes it seems so difficult for us to follow you. I mean, we just admire people like Katie, who went to Uganda, and Lord, we just say, wow, that was so easy for her to do that. And we couldn't do anything like that. But Lord, you're not asking all of us to do that.
But Lord, you are asking us to follow you, to trust you, to remember that you know what's best, and to allow you to be Lord and Father. Help us, Lord, to continue just to walk with you, to be with you, to serve you. Help us to go wholeheartedly on track. And we ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. As our usher